Welcome to Love Fellowship Believers, a non-denominational church desiring to fulfill God's will. We invite you to join us in an atmosphere of praise and worship and the powerful teachings of Christ delivered in a most creative way that reaches every age. Located at 1900 Martin Luther King Jr. Boulevard in Greensboro, North Carolina, on the wonderful campus of Gillespie Park Elementary School. This year, we're focusing on building a foundation solidified by grace, with walls made by faith, and our homes being filled with salvation by being united in living devotion. We promise you, visiting us online or in the sanctuary will be an experience that will be life-changing and one you'll never forget. We hope to see you soon. Services begin at 11 a.m. Have a blessed day.
I hope to speak somewhat to, not directly to that situation, but you'll get an idea where I'm trying to go as I move into this message, because regardless of who's in charge, God still has the last word. I want to read again verses 1 and 2 of Luke chapter 3, just to seek my own foundation in this word and try to deliver this message in a way that I haven't done it before. I've tried to preach from this scripture before, and you know what they say, if at first you don't succeed, try again. It reads, "Now in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea. Herod was tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip, tetrarch of Iturea in the region of Trachonitis, and Lysanias being the tetrarch of Abilene, Annas and Caiaphas being the high priests. The word of the Lord came unto John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness." And then it goes on to say, "And he went into all the region around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins." And I want to talk for a few minutes about the strange ways of God. The strange ways of God. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I pray right now that the words of my mouth and a meditation of my heart will be acceptable in your sight, my Lord, my strength, and my Redeemer. You may be seated. Yes, I want to talk about the strange ways of God, because when reading the scripture, the first thing that comes to mind is this is a lot of useless information. Who really cares about who the governor was of Judea in 17 AD? Who cares about Tiberius Caesar and Herod and Philip and Licinius? And who but Jews who like history really care about Annas and Caiaphas being the high priests? When reading these scriptures, one has to ask the question, why not just start this chapter with, "The word of God came to John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness"? Why take us through all of this seemingly useless information? As a way of background, the nation of Israel had been invaded and taken over by the Roman government. The people of Israel had no power, and the laws of God had little meaning to the Roman authorities. If we take a closer look at this crew, Tiberius Caesar was a stepson of Augustus Caesar as emperor of Rome. It was during the reign of Tiberius Caesar and under the order of Pontius Pilate that Jesus Christ was crucified. Pontius Pilate was the Roman governor of Judea during that time, and Pilate was no friend of the Jews. They held each other in mutual contempt. He avoided visits to Jerusalem as much as possible. It was Pilate who had the sign placed over the cross of Jesus. This was the Roman custom used to publicly declare the crime for which a person was being crucified. In the case of Jesus, Pilate had the sign say, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." It was a sarcastic comment aimed at the religious authorities who had Jesus falsely condemned to death for their own political reasons. Herod, Philip, and Licinius were tetrarchs, and a tetrarch is a ruler over a portion of a province, sort of like our county commissioners. They ruled certain portions of a province in that region. And a tetrarch is a subordinate ruler to a governor. Annas and Caiaphas were the high priests who were mentioned because Annas was forcefully removed from power, from office by the Romans, and Joseph Caiaphas was his son-in-law, and they installed him as the chief priest. The Jews considered Annas to be legitimate high priest, and Joseph Caiaphas was his son-in-law. The religious leaders during that time felt they were losing their power over the people because of this Jesus fellow coming and getting all of this attention. So they wanted him dead. Now, someone in here might ask the question, what does all of this information mean for my life? Israel had waited for over 400 years for this moment. Luke was not Jewish. He was a Gentile doctor. But he recognized the importance of the time he was living in, so he made sure he got the details right. He made sure he got the dates right. Doctors are meticulous in their documentation, so the next time you come back to see them, they'll know where they left off. So they make meticulous notes. Luke wanted to be certain that he got the details right. It seems as though the writer of this gospel was setting the stage for something really important that was about to happen. And I wanted to ask Dr. Luke, why did you start this chapter the way that you did? English teachers would tell you, you don't start a story with the word now. That's no way to start a story. You don't start a story by saying now. Stories start out by saying once upon a time, or in the beginning, or it was a dark and stormy night. This was no way to tell a story. And then why go through this long, drawn out description of who, what, when, where, why, and how? Why take us through all of that history? And why fill us up with so much seemingly useless information? He could have just started out this chapter with the word of God came to John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness. But I've seen the preparations for a boxing match where the promoters hype up the fight so much in advance, months in advance. They do newspaper ads, they do television ads, and press conferences with both fighters who give the appearance that they hate each other so much, as long as the cameras are rolling, that they can't wait to get it on. They can barely contain themselves. They give the appearance of two people who hate so much. So the promoters hype up the event. The fighters trade insults and sometimes throw punches. But all of this activity is really setting the stage for something really important that's about to happen. Concert promoters, months before the concert, start advertising the events on radio and TV. And they play a few seconds of the artist's songs to get the people so hyped up to make you want to run right out and buy the tickets right now before they're all gone. Again, it's a build-up to something really important that's about to happen. Back to these characters. Tiberius Caesar was the emperor of Rome. He controlled all of the Roman territories. Jesus Christ was born in Bethlehem, and Judea about 4 BC while the Jews were under Roman occupation. He was born around the time Augustus Caesar issued taxes, and he was baptized in the 15th year of Tiberius Caesar, which was 29 AD. Pontius Pilate was the sixth Roman governor over Judea. Pilate was a highly political man, and the Jews knew that if they threatened complaints to his superiors in Rome, that they could get the governor to act in their favor. So Luke wanted to point out just how bad the state of Jewish society was under Roman occupation. The Jews that sunk in were reduced to the lowest and moral and religious deaths because society was really messed up. But these were the people in power, the important people in society. It seems like everything that could be said about those in power had already been said. My first point is God is not impressed with your status in life. To some, the people in power were great men. They had achieved great status in life. How could you top the regalness and majesty and pageantry of Tiberius Caesar, Emperor of Rome, the most dominant power on the face of the earth? When Caesar came through, folks got back. Folks dropped to their knees, crying out, "Hail Caesar! Hail Caesar!" This was Caesar, who, for all intents and purposes, in the eyes of the Roman citizens, this was Caesar, Lord of the earth. And who could compare to Pontius Pilate, governor of the province representing the mightiest government on the face of the earth? It was Pilate who slaughtered citizens in Galilee in the 13th chapter. This was Pilate who had so much authority and power that he tried Jesus and ordered his death after learning that Jesus had died on Calvary. But Pilate had that much power. Then Herod and Philip and Licinius were tetrarchs, leaders, rulers over portions of provinces. And then Annas and Caiaphas, the high priests. For priests, there were no higher religious aspirations than to become the high priest. It was a high priest who offered the sacrifices for the sins of the people once a year in the holiest of holies. So it seemed like everything that could be said about people in ultimate power and authority had already been said. But I assure you, all of this was nothing more than background material. It was setting the stage for something really important that was about to happen. Because in verse 2, something strange happened. God looked past all of these important people in power because the word of God came to John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness. God is not impressed with your status in life. In today's society, a local county judge has so much power they can sentence someone to life in prison. Judges are seen as people of power in our society. But God is not concerned about our worldly achievements in life. Someone suggested that greatness is not measured by what you have, but greatness is measured by your faith in God. Last week, a man running for president with orange hair, insulting everyone in his path, and supported mainly by angry, uneducated people in the majority. As scary as this seems, he still does not have the last word. God is still in control. God transacts business in strange ways. The word of God came to John in the wilderness. I'm telling you, God is not impressed with your status in life. My second point is that God does some of his best work in remote places. When you compare the people in power to John the Baptist, you begin to get a sense of what really matters. As we look at the life of John, it was not a perfect life. John, his name means the grace of Jehovah, meaning that he was to introduce the grace and truth that was to come through Jesus Christ. This was John, who was so concerned about the voice of God that he was no longer concerned about the voice of man. This was John, the wild man of the desert, who wore sheepskins for clothes and ate the meals of the poor, which was locusts and wild honey. This was John, who was so unpopular with the rulers and church leaders because he told the church leaders, the leaders of the synagogue, you have to get yourself right in the sight of God. This was John who told Herod, you're wrong for marrying your brother's wife while your brother is still alive. And that cost him his head, literally. But this was John who prepared the way of the Lord. This was John, the baptizer of Jesus. John was not politically correct. He didn't care about delivering a popular message. He could care less about hurting the feelings or rebuking the leaders. Flattery and commendation were not in his vocabulary. He came to prepare the way of the Lord and tell us all to repent or perish. This was John, an imperfect messenger, delivering a perfect message. This was John in the wilderness. And what is it about this wilderness? What kind of place is that to receive the word of God? Why couldn't it have been in some royal palace in Rome? Why not Solomon's temple or Herod's temple? Taj Mahal or Caesar's palace? But why in some remote, desolate place as a wilderness? To the Jews, the wilderness represented failure and disappointment. The wilderness represented lost opportunities. The wilderness represented lost souls and misdirected faith. The wilderness represented isolation and desolation and trouble. The wilderness represented a nation of people on a 40-year death march. The wilderness is scary. I've always said, if you and a friend are out in the wilderness and the bear starts chasing you, you don't have to worry about outrunning the bear. You just have to worry about outrunning your friend. Because one bear can't catch two people. Somebody got caught 911, right? Somebody got to report it. Think about it. God does some of his best work in remote places. I've listed all the important people of power at that time, but when Jesus was asked the question, who is the greatest person in the kingdom of God? He said, John the Baptist. He didn't say Herod or Pilate or Philip, but he said, John the Baptist. All those rulers have been promptly forgotten. Nothing more than background material. John's message was one of repentance. Prepare the way of the Lord. Get ready. But this was John who received the word of God in the wilderness. As preachers of the gospel, sometimes we get caught up in worrying about who our audience will be, instead of focusing on who it is we're actually preaching about. John didn't care who came out to hear him. What really mattered is that he preached the word of God. As humans, it matters to us where we receive the word of God, but not to God. That's why the word of God didn't come to John in the palaces of the high and mighty. The word of God didn't come to John in the Congress or in the Senate, but the word of God came to John the Baptist in the wilderness, because God does some of his best work in remote places. My third point, once the word of God comes into your life, everything else is background material. Everything that happened in the past made you what you are now. As humans, we spend so much time worrying about things that may never happen. Many of our lives and plans we have for our lives have not turned out the way we thought they would. Parents disappoint children, and children disappoint parents. we have hopes and dreams that will never be fulfilled in this life. One day we feel fine, the next day we're in the hospital. A few months ago, the man who cuts my lawn told me about his cousin. They were cutting down a tree. His cousin was up in a tree with a chainsaw. The chainsaw slipped and hit an artery, died in the yard. The fact is, things happen to all of us at some time in life, both good things and bad things. All of us have highs and lows and peaks and valleys, times when things are going well and times when it just seems like everything we touch turns to dust. One day we're fine, the next day we're sick. One day all of our loved ones are with us, the next day someone's missing. Sometimes this life can be so uncertain. Many of us lie awake at nights with problems we cannot solve and answers that just won't seem to come. But someone in here needs to know that everything that happened in your life until the day you came into a relationship with Jesus Christ was nothing more than background material. Your whole story has yet to be told. Amen. As I look back at my life, all of my disappointments, all of my heartbreaks and pain and failure, all of my shortcomings, it was just background material. It was God setting the stage for something really important that was about to happen. In Philippians 3:13, Paul talks about background material. He said, "Brethren, I count myself not to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." Paul said, he talked about background material. He said, forgetting. Do you know that Satan is a specialist at bringing up past hurtful memories from your childhood? Problems in a relationship, but he specializes in bringing up past hurtful memories. And they stop us from moving forward because we get thrown off. We focus on that painful memory. We can't do a single thing to change what happened to cause that memory. We can't do a single thing about it. We can't go back and change it. But Satan specializes in bringing back those painful, hurtful memories because he's on assignment. His assignment is to steal, kill, and destroy. If he can steal your joy, he's got you for that day. Let me bring this message to an end, if I can make this message more contemporary. Travel with me to the year 2009. It was the first year of the U.S. presidency of Barack Obama. Beverly Perdue was the governor of North Carolina. Roy Cooper was a state attorney general. Reverend Billy Graham and Reverend Rick Warren were the high priests of white evangelical Christianity in America. But the word of God came to Pastor Kevin Webb in Greensboro, North Carolina. I'm telling you, God does some of his best work in remote places. He could have sent Pastor Webb to a more cosmopolitan city, Charlotte, New York, Washington, but he sent him to a new ministry in Greensboro, North Carolina. I'm telling you, God does some of his best work in remote places. And because Pastor Webb answered the call, someone in this room was led to Christ. Someone in this room has a sense of hope. Through him, someone has a deeper knowledge about the power and love of God. God does some of his best work in remote places. Here's my final thought. All the people in power from the scripture are dead, but the word of God is still here. Jesus said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall remain forever. Jesus, one name given under heaven by which men must be saved. The next time I get sick, I'm not wasting my time calling on Tiberius Caesar, Emperor of Rome. The next time your son or daughter is in trouble, don't waste your time praying to Pontius Pilate, governor of Judea. When your bills are unpaid and your money is funny, don't waste your time praying to Philip, the tetrarch of Iturea in the region of Trachonitis. When the praises were going up today, when the testimonies were going forth, I didn't hear anyone thanking Annas and Caiaphas, the high priest. Deacon Stacy, I don't think you were giving thanks and praises to Licinius, the tetrarch of Abilene, when you gave your testimony. During my last week in Greensboro, I called the people who delivered my wheelchair to come and get it. When a man came to get it, it was by my front door. He said, I've got it from here. I said, no, I need to do this, and I'll tell you why. So I rode the wheelchair to his van, and I picked it up and lifted it and put it inside the van. And he said, I told you I got this. I said, no, I need to do this, because now I can tell somebody that I was able to carry what used to carry me. I didn't think Herod. I didn't think Pilate. I didn't think Philip. I said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. God could have chosen any one of these so-called important people to deliver his word, but God chose to speak through a loner, the wild man of the desert, preaching in the wilderness, named John the Baptist. And he preached about Jesus. There's one name given under heaven by which men must be saved. When we say, Father, in the name of Jesus, that gets heaven's attention. Jesus, that name I first heard on my mother's lips. She didn't sing, oh, how I love Caesar, oh, how I love Pilate, oh, how I love Herod. She sang, oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. These are the strange ways of God. And when it comes to Jesus Christ, how in the world can anybody explain Jesus? Before he was born, he was formed in the womb, his mother impregnated by the Holy Spirit. God works in some strange ways. A king born in a manger with some cattle and sheep. That's strange. As an infant, he frightened the king. How can you explain Jesus? As a young boy, he reasoned with the doctors and lawyers. And he did some things we would consider strange. If a man fishes for a living, we call him a fisherman. But what do you call a man that can take two fish and five barley loaves and feed 5,000 men plus women and children? When a man makes wine, he is called a vintner. But what in the world do you call the man who takes water and turns it into wine? When someone is blind, we send them to an ophthalmologist. But what do you call a man who spits in the clay and rubs it on a man's eyes, and a man who was born blind can now see? What do you call a man like that? When someone dies, we bury them. But before that, we send the body to an undertaker or a mortician. But what do you call a man that speaks to the dead simply by saying, Lazarus, come forth? And the old preachers used to say, it's a good thing he said Lazarus, because if he had not said Lazarus come forth, all of the dead from Adam on would have come out of the grave. Let me end this. Now in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea. Herod was tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip, tetrarch of Iturea and the region of Trachonitis. Licinius was tetrarch of Abilene. Annas and Caiaphas were high priests. The word of the Lord came to John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness. The word of God, who is Jesus. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. If you call on any other name when you're in trouble, if you call on my name when you're in trouble, you really don't understand how much trouble you're really in. But that one name, Jesus, I'm appealing to now to that man or that woman. Doesn't matter what happened in the past. Doesn't matter what happened the day you got caught up. Doesn't matter what happened the day you messed up. Doesn't matter what happened in the past. When Jesus comes into your life, everything else can become background material. He comes looking for you. And he stands at your door and he knocks, waiting for you to open up the door so he can come in. Jesus said, I stand at the door and knock. It doesn't matter who you are or what you've done. The word of God, the Lord of hosts, wants to come into your heart. He wants to take your problems and make them his problems. And we know that when he takes them, they no longer become a problem in your life. Jesus is the only one that can save you. He does it because of the strange ways of God. God bless you.
Amen, amen, amen. Come on, can we put our hands together? Amen, amen, amen. Come on, let's put our hands together for Dr. Williams. Amen, blessing us, amen. Amen, can we put our hands together for the Lord? How about that?